Hi, I'm Stuart Skinner, number 74 for the Edmonton Oilers, number 34 for the Bakersfield Condors, and I'm coming on I Only Touch Greatness podcast.
Hi, I'm Raphael Lavoie, and I Only Touch Greatness podcast.
Hey, I'm Devin Brasso, number 14 for the Bakersfield Condors, and I'm coming on I Only Touch Greatness podcast.
Looking for the most beers on tap, great steaks, great staff? Head over to the John B. Pub.
We got the best beers, steaks, chicken wings, nachos in town. Come see us at the John B. Pub.
The John B. Pub, the best bar in town. Come sign up for our football pool. Say hey, sent you.
Turn it up. The number one sports podcast in Vancouver with Ryan Hayes and Big Mike.
Ryan Hayes and Big Mike are taking over the podcast scene in Vancouver. Get down or lay down.
Will Warm.
That's it. Blue line ball horn. Right point. Zabrinsky shot. Save. Kid shot. Skinner save.
Here's Joki Haru. A shot. Good save. Rebound. Skinner got it. Oh, a terrific stop. Drop pass for Smart. Put to the front. Tip towards the net. Hosinger. Great. Save. Skinner. Breakaway.
Last to 12 Dane. Outlet pass to center. Here comes Griffith over the blue line with Crackle. Griffith pulls up. Tipped in front. They score. It's Raphael Lavoie. And it's first in the American Hockey League. Three high for the Condors. Here's Lavoie. Right circle. He shoots and scores. Rebel carries deep. Holds it right circle. Top of the right dot. Benson cross ice. One timer scores. Raphael Lavoie from Tyler Benson. And the Condors are on the board.
We're sort of the offensive zone. We're sort of the circle of shot. Score!
What a heads-up pass, Connor McCarthy. And Devin Brasso had all kinds of time and space.
Devin, born in Quebec, tell us a little bit of childhood playing minor hockey and your transition to the BC Hockey League where you played for the Clippers.
Yeah, it's actually a pretty good story. I'll start with my minor hockey. I played around here. I'm from Montreal, so on the South Shore of Montreal, played here till I was about played for the minor team here in St. Lambert for, I don't know, like 10, 12 years, and then it kind of transitioned to a bigger territory, I'm sure, like every guy here in Canada, and then played Midget Triple A here as well. Then when it came to the Q draft, I didn't get drafted to the Q. That's when I kind of got the idea of kind of wanting to play NCAA and taking that route, and played my first junior year here actually for my hometown in Quebec. It was like junior, well, it's called junior AAA here in Quebec, but it's actually junior A in Canada. I was lucky enough to actually get drafted by the hometown team, which was nice. That's kind of why I played there the first year. And so after that, that's when it kind of gets funny and interesting. Someone had came up to me. I knew out west it was a little more recruited in terms of the NCAA. And so someone came up to me after the end of my first junior year and said, "Hey, I heard you want to go to BC." And at the time, Boston College was actually my dream school. That's the kind of school I was like kind of looking up to and want to go. And so I'm like, "Oh my God, yeah!" Like, you know, he's like, "Get you in contact, we could set that up, there'll be no problem." I'm like, "Oh my God, is it that easy?" You know, like So this guy sends me a number and says, you don't call this guy, and he's the coach for the team, blah, blah, blah. So I call and ends up being the Nanaimo Clippers in the BCHL. And he meant the BCHL. I thought it meant Boston College, but and then kind of went from there, tried to invite myself on the team in Nanaimo and just kind of asked him, hey, you want to give me a shot here? And ended up playing 3 years there, you know, so kind of a weird way to get there, but panned out, I guess.
Absolutely. That's awesome. And I'm going to butcher the name, but is it Raphael? Is that how you say it?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay. Born in Quebec. Tell us a little bit about childhood with you and playing minor hockey and your transition to the Q with Halifax and Chicoutimi.
Yeah, well, I played, you know, really close to my hometown pretty much my whole life. And then suddenly you get drafted to Halifax and you're 1,200 kilometers away from home. And, you know, I didn't have much of an interesting parkour. I just went there junior and then I got drafted and I ended up going to Bakersfield afterwards.
Okay. And Stuart, born in Edmonton, tell us a little bit about childhood playing minor hockey and your transition to the Dub, where you played for Lethbridge and Swift Current.
Yeah, it was. I played in Edmonton growing up. Played for Southside Athletic Club on the south side of Edmonton, obviously, and got to play with my buddy James Hamlin and Tyler Benson, who all of us are playing with the past year in Bakersfield, and we won the Chick Cup this year. But when we won, when I was playing in Southside Athletic Club with those guys, we won 2 years in a row. So me, Benny, and Hams like to say that when the three of us are together, we just win championships. So not a big deal, but it's
right on. That's awesome. Yeah, but,
so grew up playing for those guys. We had a great team. I mean, Benny was like the highest scoring guy on the team. He just kind of wrecked the league and Bantam. And then, I got drafted to Lethbridge and was grateful enough to make the team when I was 16 years old for my first year. And played about 3.5 years in Lethbridge. There's some pretty good seasons. Our first season was a little bit tougher. And then got traded the last half of my year in to Swifty. And it was an amazing team. We had some incredible players. And we went all the way. And we ended up winning the Edgenelf Cup in the WHL. And that's one of my best moments in hockey is being able to win a championship in the Western Hockey League and being able to go to Regina to play in the Memorial Cup. And after that, before that, I got drafted to Edmonton. And then after my WHL career, went and played in Wichita for a year. And then second year played in Baco. And then this past year back in Bakersfield.
Yeah. We love your guys' team. So we can't wait to see you guys come out here and play Abbotsford now.
Yeah, can't wait.
Yeah.
Can't wait to beat them.
That's the right answer, but we'll see.
That's right.
Yeah, and we know we've met Benson a few times too from being a Vancouver Giant.
Yeah, no, he's an amazing guy. He's a good player too, and him and I always joke that when we're together we just end up winning.
Yeah,
okay. Hey, there's nothing wrong with that.
I'll have to take note.
That's right. Any nicknames, and what's your guys' favorite jersey number and why?
I can go first. I've always kind of been called either Dev or Bross, obviously because the last name Russo. But this year is the first one for me. Guys were calling me DB by my initials, so didn't mind it at all. I actually kind of liked it, so went with that. And then 41 used to be my favorite number, kind of still is. Then I started wearing 14. Up in college, it was my grandfather's number, and so kind of stuck with that and kind of made sense. It was kind of the opposite of 41 and wore that through college at Clarkson, and then got to play overseas before the start of last season there in Austria. So went back to 41 and back to 14 in Baco. So luckily that number was still open, and you know, looking to rock that for a while. So
good number. Yeah. Good number. That's my number too.
There you go. Oh, there. I see it in the back.
Oh, and then Metcalf.
Is and his, favorite, too, yeah.
He's my favorite player, but my actual hockey number is 14. I got the 14 tattoo as well.
There you go.
Yeah. Mike?
Yeah. You go ahead, Rafi.
Okay, I'll go ahead. Yeah. Well, my nicknames, I got Raf, Raffy, and then Lavi. It's pretty much different for everyone, but I don't mind either ones. Yeah, my number is 50. I originally got that number when I was pretty young. It's for my father, basically. He had cancer when I was young, and you know, it's been pretty tough, like almost losing my dad, and the whole story behind it was pretty a long thing for me and my family. So he was officially in remission at age 50. So I always felt like it was a nice little touch to, like, you know, have a number 50. So every time I would see it, it'd be like a little reminder that there's more to hockey in life, you know, like you got families and stuff like that. And, you know, everywhere I went that I could have it, I went, I got it. And now I might have an issue because Stewie has that number now in Edmonton. So I don't know what we're going to have to do with that.
I changed up. Like, I went for 74. So 50 is all yours, buddy.
Okay, I'll take it. Yeah.
You shouldn't have told him.
I was just gonna say you shouldn't have told him. I look like Skinner could use a new Rolex.
Yeah.
I wouldn't do that to my bud. I wouldn't do that to you. Yeah. My nickname is Goals. You could pretty well do anything with Skinner. I mean, you got Skinzy, Skinny. Skin dog, you got a whole bunch you could do with that. My dad growing up would always call me Stewie. If you kind of just meet me, most of the time people call me Stu. But yeah, you can do a lot with it. I've pretty well heard everything. And my number 74, I grew up with a big family, and we had four boys in my family, and the oldest was number 71, and then the second oldest was 72. And then the one just older than me was 73. So I decided to keep it going and go for 74. And it's kind of been just a family tradition. And I think my dad was number 70 when he was younger as well. So all the boys in the family kind of kept it from 70 to 74. So I just wanted to keep it going. And even though I'm a goalie, I was like, might as well. I can be unique with it. So, no, it's that's the reason why I got 74 on my back.
So if you guys were having a dream dinner party and you could invite three famous people dead or alive, who are you inviting?
It's a good question.
That is a good question.
It's a good question if you get to go last, because you get the chance to think about it.
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead, bro.
Yeah, put the pressure on me to go first.
If you want, for example, I always go with Tupac, Seth Rogen, and then Hulk Hogan.
That's good.
Those are good ones, yeah. That's really good.
All right, I'll go first. That's some pressure. I think I'd have to go Will Ferrell, Usain Bolt, and Blake Lively.
Yeah.
There you go.
Good thing, Ryan Reynolds will be there either.
Yeah, exactly.
I think for me, the three guys that I would go for is I go Matthew McConaughey.
Okay.
I would go Will Ferrell as well. That would just be a hilarious dinner. That'd be a great time. And then the third one, I would say Margot Robbie, but I just got married, so I better keep that to myself. And then probably. I'm not too sure. That's a really good question. Third one, I'd probably go Floyd Mayweather. I think that'd be
cool. I like it. Floyd Money.
Yeah. First one that comes to mind, I'd go Dennis Rodman. Pretty electrifying guy. I'd be curious to see how that guy's doing. Might go Conor McGregor too, you know, another polarizing guy. I'd like to have a good dinner with those guys. And third one, I kind of like the Blake one.
Yeah. I'm kind of thinking I do too.
Yeah, that's a good pick.
I've always thought she was a beauty. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And then of course Van City Reynolds has got her. So,
that's right.
Yeah.
Luckily. I start. I I think I got a crush on her when I was watching Gossip Girl back in juniors.
Oh, yeah. yeah, that's for sure. And then I just thought of another one I should be adding to my list here. Kenny Powers. If you ever seen
that. That'd be pretty good.
I think that would be fun. The character anyways, not so much the real guy.
Devin, probably the biggest day for you in your career, signing with the Oilers organization after playing a bit in Europe. What was the Europe experience like, and how did all the signing go down?
So I actually signed right after college, you know, with that whole is when the pandemic hit, our season got cut short at Clarkson. It was my fourth year there, and you know, just kind of talking with Edmonton and Bakersfield, and just felt like it was the right fit. You know, maybe had a couple other options, but, you know, overall, I thought that's, you know, it's a good place to grow, good place to develop myself. And, you know, and obviously we had a great team this past year. And so still think it's, you know, the perfect place for me to play. And so after that, you know, with things not really starting up here in North America, you know, Edmonton actually brought up the idea for a few of us. I think Rafi went overseas as well to kind of just go out there and play some hockey. I mean, we hadn't played in like 6, 7, 8 months, some of us. So said, yeah, they brought up the idea, said, yeah. A week later, I was gone. I was in Austria, and actually got to go with Yanni Caldas, who, you know, was with us in Bakersfield. And I had originally played in Nanaimo juniors with him as well. I had brought him over there for 2 years, and we played each other. He was at Cornell, I was at Clarkson. So the big rivals throughout the 4 years, and get to tease him every day. I took a ring off his finger, but that's another story. but yeah, so he came with me overseas. You know, Bakersfield kind of sent us both, Edmonton sent us both over there, and it was awesome. I mean, even if everything was kind of closed up, we got to play some hockey, kind of live the Euro hockey style a little bit. It's different style hockey, and you know, on the big pond over there, and kind of get that experience. It's you know, a lot of guys were saying over there how it's usually reverse. You usually play pro here in North America and kind of switch over to Europe at one point if that's the case. And I got to experience that first, so it's pretty cool.
Yeah.
And Stu, one of only 7 goalies to score in the WHL when you were at Lethbridge. taking back to that goal, and do you still have that puck?
I definitely do have that puck. I think it's in my dad's got a little place where he keeps all my trophies and like my old helmets from ever since I was in Pee Wee. So I think he's got that locked up somewhere in his office. And yeah, that was a pretty cool moment. I actually got the puck. My one of my buddies, I played with him on the SSAC, Southside Athletic Club, growing up as well. David Quinville, he dumped it in on me. And he's like my good buddy. And I kind of, yeah, just stopped the rim and kind of looked up. I was like, yeah, might as well, let's, you know, go for it. And it ended up going in. And the funny story is that the day before we were in practice and all the guys were like shooting, the coach was like, hey, like if you miss the net, we're going to do, you know, over and back. But if you score, we can get off. And I think like 5 guys went and they missed the net. And so, coach was Brent Kissio, and he was like, all right, Stu, your turn. And everybody was like, oh my gosh, like get ready to skate. And I absolutely like drilled it in the middle, and we got off. And then the next day I scored. So everybody was like, that's kind of funny. You're kind of practicing it for the next day. So yeah, it was a crazy moment. That's awesome. did the whole flyby, and it was a lot of fun.
All right.
And then taking me back to 2017 when you were drafted 78th overall by the hometown team, the Oilers.
Yeah, that was an incredible experience. I mean, the draft was in Chicago, so got to go fly and enjoy Chicago for 3-4 days. I mean, it was a beautiful city, beautiful time. Got to go on a little boat cruise, kind of just went around the city and had some deep dish pizza. There's some really good food over there. Yeah, it was an amazing time. Yeah, I think going into the second round, we kind of got there pretty early into the building, and I was kind of just waiting to hear my name. And it's actually funny. Oilers kind of came up. I was like, oh, these guys are definitely going to be passing on me. Like, no chance I'm going to get drafted there. So I kind of leaned back in my chair and kind of was looking around, and I heard my name get called, but I didn't actually like realize my name got called. So I looked at my girlfriend at the time, wife now, Chloe, and we kind of looked at each other and a little bit shocked. And then I like slowly got out of my chair because I was like, is this actually happening? Like, did they actually call my name? So it was a pretty surreal moment. It was, it was so much fun. And I'm super grateful to get drafted by my hometown team. I mean, I grew up watching those guys. So it was one of the cooler moments in my career so far.
Of course. And Rafi, this past season, you got to play a little bit in Europe too. What was your experience like there? And also take me back to 2019 when you were drafted 38th overall by the Edmonton Oilers.
I went to Sweden and basically was one of my buddies that I trained with during the summer. It just literally happened in an afternoon. Like, same with DB. I got floated the idea of like going to Europe, and we're literally changing, going on the ice. And I tell that to my buddy, and my buddy's playing in the SHL. And he's like, oh, you know what? Like, let me just call my GM and I'll get back to you. And like 3 hours later, he's like, yeah, Rafa, you know, he'd love to try you out. Like, so just come over. And basically that's how I went to Sweden and didn't end up working out with that team, but I ended up finding another team. And, you know, it was just a great season. It was plenty of things that are like just different from here, you know? And it was a great experience. It was awesome, awesome time over there. I've learned plenty. I've done plenty of things. And yeah, I think it helped me a lot in my growth as a person, as a player. So that was a good experience. And for the draft, it was in Vancouver, actually. It was where you guys are from.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
We were so, you know, I just went there, had the whole family with me. It was a pretty unreal experience. But I didn't think I was going to get drafted by the Oilers because I only had, like, I had one interview with them throughout the season that lasted about 7 minutes. And when I went at the combine, I talked to them and it probably lasted like 10 minutes. It was probably one of my shortest interviews. So I was like, you know, like some teams brought me out to dinner, like stuff like that. Like some teams were showing more interest. And so I was like, I didn't see them. I didn't think I was going to get drafted there. And then suddenly they just called my name and, was pretty awesome. Yeah.
Absolutely. It was a good feeling.
Yeah.
And if there was $1,000 prize on the line and you had to sing one karaoke song, what song are you singing? All you guys get ready for that one.
Oh, ask these guys how I sang Black Betty on the bus.
Yeah, that was phenomenal. That got the boys going.
I'll give myself a pat on the back for that one. I'm definitely bringing that back.
Okay.
Money on the line, no doubt.
You're probably winning the money too after singing that song. For sure you are. You're like half Fergie, half Jesus.
And Rafi and Stu?
I got Someone Like You by Adele. Pretty sure I was buzzing on that when I was younger, so it just stayed in my mind. If I have to do a whole song without any mistakes, I think it'd be that one.
Okay.
All right.
I think for me, it'd be Tequila. You know,
good answer.
Nice and easy.
Yeah, people don't know to go for that one, and then it keeps coming up, people saying it. So yeah, that's my answer too now.
This one's for Devin and for Rafi. Take me back to your guys' first AHL goal with the Condors.
Yeah, first goal was actually my first game, lucky enough. I think it was like my second shift too. I was playing with two of the veterans there, Bugsy Malone and Joe Gambardella. So I think it was just a down low shift, kind of just buzzing around. The guy, we were doing some board work, puck into the point. I was just kind of standing net front and kind of all alone, I think, actually. And Lenstrom, Lenny just, you know, floated a puck in and I got a tip on it and went in. So it was nice to get the first one out of the way pretty quick.
Okay. Yeah, mine wasn't the first game. It was, I think, third or fourth. I know it was against Vegas. And basically, I just gave the puck to Griff and then I drive the net and he's like, he sauces. He makes like a pretty nice pass. He sauces it right to me and then I just tip it like in top net, and then that was it. I got a good slash after that. I don't know who it was from, but I know like I got a good slash after that goal. I don't know why, but yeah, that was my first goal.
Okay.
Okay. And Stu, obviously you haven't scored in the AHL yet, but NHL debut, first career start, the 31st of 2021 against Ottawa, and your first win. Taking you back to that game.
Yeah, it was, it was a day you would never forget, playing your first NHL game. It was a lot of fun, I got the news the day before and watched the game from the box, actually. And then the next day woke up and was kind of like, hey, like, you know, this is the day you're going to be playing your first NHL game. So it was a super exciting day. Tried to keep the same as any other game, any other day. You don't want to try to do too much or, mess your routine up for any reason. So, it was kind of just a relaxing day. You know, I had my regular pregame meal, pregame nap. Went to the rink, got to hang out with the guys, got to play some sewer ball, stretch out a bit, and then getting up to warm up. That's kind of when it started to hit me. Taking warm ups as a starting goaltender, you take the most reps, obviously, with the puck. So when we first got out there, me having to start the warm up and everything, I was kind of like, okay, this is actually happening. This is getting pretty real here. And then it definitely hit me when the anthem came on, and I was looking at Tkachuk and looking at the Ottawa Senators logo, and I was like, wow, like, it's an actual NHL game, and this is really cool that I get to play against these guys, and I get to wear, the Oilers logo on my chest, and this is what I grew up dreaming about. This is the team I grew up watching and dreaming that, I was going to be playing for the Edmonton Oilers. So to actually be doing it was really surreal and at times overwhelming, but you got to kind of put that down into your feelings and kind of, focus on stopping the puck. And I'm just happy we got the win. Leo and Dave will definitely help me out by popping in 8 or 9 or whatever it was. But it was, the first period was a little tough for me. I was definitely a little shaky. But once I got the first period out of the way, I kind of took a deep breath and I was like, okay, like, I did it for one period. So, let's just be solid for the next and just, be who I am. And I think once I got my breath and once I got my feet under me, I think that's kind of when I started to play better and started to kind of, see that, I can definitely be playing in the NHL.
Got the jitters out. You were good to go.
Exactly. See, yeah. Just took me like 40 minutes.
this one's for all you guys as well. Do you guys have a dream venue that you want to play in one day?
I mean, for me, it's the Bell Center in Montreal, a little bit like Skins. I grew up watching the Habs play all the time, and the fam, and we're still big fans of Montreal, for the playoffs and stuff, and just watching the games when the Bell Center is packed. It's obviously I'm a little biased, but I think it's hard to beat. So definitely would want to play there in that venue at least once in my life.
Okay.
Yeah, that's pretty much the same thing for me. I mean, I grew up 20 minutes outside of Montreal. Like, I was going to Habs game, like, pretty often. I mean, I've watched Alex Killorn with the Stanley Cup in front of the Bell Center. Like, I thought that, like, that was something that I was like, if I ever win the Cup, like, that might be something I'd want to do. So, the Bell Center is at the top of the list right now. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think for me, Bell Center is definitely one of them. I actually got sent down right when we went to Montreal. So I was kind of bummed out about it because I was like, oh, that would have been sweet to see, what the Bell Center is all about and what everyone talks about. And another one for me would be New York City. I think that's a huge one. And yeah, absolutely. And, that's when you kind of, when you watch those games, they're just electric and they're so much fun. And you see all these celebrities going to these games and it would just be really, really cool. And really, it'd be a very cool experience to be able to play in front of all those people and to make a save and hear everybody go wild. I think that's the dream, right? So.
Oh yeah,
absolutely. Do you guys have any pregame rituals or routines?
Not too much. I mean, I think just get to the rink, have a coffee, hang out with the guys a little bit, play some sewer ball, kind of give Stewie the treatment in sewer ball. then just kind of get a warm up in and get on the ice. I'm a pretty casual guy. I like to keep it loose and crack jokes and talk to the guys and all that stuff. So I'm not too serious when it comes to kind of getting ready. But yeah, other than showing Stewie how to play, not much.
Yeah, I don't do much, honestly. I just walk around, talk with the guys, take my sticks for about 40 minutes, and then play a little bit of sewer. Next thing you know, I need to get dressed to go on the ice. So try to keep it relaxed and be smooth with it, and puts me in that mindset to play a good game.
Okay.
Yeah, growing up, I had a lot of stuff actually going on before, and then the older you get, the more games you play, you kind of realize you can't be too hard on your body, and you got to kind of, you know, stay a little bit more relaxed. But it depends what kind of person you are. But I do some stretching and some rolling out that I just do for a routine. It's not that I need to do it, but it's something in my head that I feel a lot better once I get that done, and that's kind of my main thing. And then after that, I show Bros the ropes, how to play some suey ball. And I know he was saying, he kind of bullies me in the game, but it's just a complete lie. He's like the first one out all the time because of me. So he's getting dressed the earliest out of all the guys playing suey ball. But no, it's play suey ball, try to stay relaxed and just have a coffee, hang out with the guys, you know, just try to enjoy that social environment. I mean, we become a brotherhood and a family, and just being able to hang out with these guys every single day before the games helps you kind of loosen up the jitters a bit. Instead of being, you know, all dialed in into the game, you can kind of talk to the guys and just joke around and have some fun. So that way, when you're going on the ice, you're kind of in a mindset of, you know, you're loose, but you're focused and you're ready. And, you know, you're ready to go to battle with the guys that you love.
Absolutely. Do you guys get your Timmies down there or no?
No Timmies and bacon, all Dunkin' Donuts.
Oh, yeah. Unfortunately. Okay.
Yeah.
By the way, Stuart, you're on my target list for next year.
I'm not worried about it.
You guys have a favorite stick tape or, yeah, what color is your stick tape?
I go white pretty much actually every game. Sometimes I'll go black a couple practices just to see how it feels, but I got to go back to white. I can't change. I'm too chicken.
Okay. Yeah, I got white too. I mean, I'm not a big style guy on the ice, so I try to keep it simple. Just take my stick properly and keep it white and everything's fine.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm the same. I'm white. So anytime these guys change their tape to black, I try to get in their head, so I do a little bit better on them. I try a little bit harder, so they think that it's like the tape is the reason why they're doing bad. Then they go back.
I like it.
I always tell the story of I got white stick tape, and then I take the puck and I put it there, and I trace it with a Sharpie, and I move it over. I trace it with the Sharpie, and I color them in, so it looks like I possibly.
It still doesn't work for you.
I give it a shot. I give it a shot. I try my best. Yeah, right. I suck.
Devin, take me back to your first tilt with Mikey Esamont this year.
Oh man, it all started when I was kind of like skating up the boards, and I got hit pretty hard. I'm pretty sure I got hit by Dersey, and at the time I got hit pretty hard. I didn't really know who hit me actually, and I was a little pissed off. Kind of got up and chasing the puck around, and I was mad kind of the whole shift, and it was a pretty tiring shift, and I just got back to go change, get to the bench there, and we kind of ran into each other in front of our bench, and as soon as I ran into him, I just said, hey, we're going, and it was kind of both of us kind of got into a tussle. It wasn't very long, a couple punch being thrown, but it was just kind of like combination of being mad and running into someone, accidentally on purpose, and then trying to get things going. I think it was a 0-0 game in the second two against Ontario.
Just getting the boys fired up.
Yeah, I was like, hey, in front of the bench, running into him, let's go. So,
yeah. I'm pretty sure we won that game, so worked out.
Then this one's for Rafi. Congratulations, obviously, on the World Junior Gold. Made our country proud. Take me back to that game and being on the ice when Thomas got the winner.
That was a pretty tough game, and like, because I think we were losing like 3-0 or 3-1, and you know, I think when they scored the third goal, I've just lost the Memorial Cup like less than a year ago, so I was like man, like I can't lose this again, like this, like I can't do that. So it was pretty hard on me, and then suddenly we just go out, and then I think it's Byron or McMichael that just fires it. I'm in front of the net and like hits like seven guys, and then it just like fumbles in, and then we just get on the ice right again after like 3-4 minutes after, and then Thomas scores this time, and well, suddenly we're back in it, you know, and like everything's going like super well. And the best part was the camera. I don't know if you guys remembered, but Aiden Dudas, he threw the puck in the window and it went over the glass, but it hit the camera and it went off the ice. And so basically he's going to the bench thinking we got a penalty, and Russia's sending their guys thinking they got a power play as well. And then they take out the rule book and they're like, well, the camera's part of the ring, so technically it's not a penalty. Their guys go crazy. And then they ended up getting a penalty actually instead, you know? And then the guy plays without a stick, and suddenly the game finishes, and we have a 5-on-3. Like, it was, and then, you know, well, obviously, when you have the 5-on-3, there's, like, a minute left, you're like, that's it, you know, we're winning this game, and it's just pretty unreal, man. Pretty sweet feeling.
Yeah, I remember that.
We just got our ring this summer.
Oh, really?
Oh, right on.
Yeah, yeah, we just got our ring, I think, a couple weeks ago, and because they didn't send them out throughout COVID, they waited after, and it was they were pretty awesome rings, man.
Holy,
I believe it,
Mike.
Yeah, I was just gonna hit them with the go-to Selly for Devin and Rafi.
Oh, Raf, what's your go-to Selly? I don't even know if I have a go-to.
I don't have one. I just put my arms in the air, and I'm just pretty happy to be there. You know, like I'm not
yeah.
I've done some sometimes, but I most of the time I don't even think about that. I'm just like, oh, I'm just happy I scored, you know.
Yeah, just kind of try to grab the closest guy to you, and you know,
yeah,
or if someone makes a nice play, I like to kind of point it out, you know, the classic. Just that's all you. I'm just there. My stick's there, but it's all you.
I'm out at beer league hockey, and I'm out there and I'm always a squirrel, and I'll take my gloves and I'll go, you can't see me, right in the goalie's face. That's usually I get jumped.
How would that go, Skinner?
I mean, in our league it probably wouldn't go so well.
No exactly.
I'll try it out.
Yeah, right.
Oh, what's your guys' go-to song before games?
I mean, last year, God, right before, I think every time we'd hop on, I think guys were playing that Let's Get Down to Business song by Tiesto. Yeah. And I mean, super loud, especially in Vaco with the sound system. Yeah, they
throw it up. Before that song, we were playing some Motley Crue, too, to like get it going, right?
Cracks would throw it on and real loud, and guys, it was actually fun. It was good to get the guys going, but yeah, I mean, I'd have to say that for the past year, kind of switches around, but yeah.
Okay.
What would you guys, if you had to describe your guys' playing style or describe your game for all three of you?
You guys go ahead. You guys start it off.
Raf, you want to go?
You can go, bros. You can go, bros.
I mean, I'm just, you know, kind of describe myself as a role guy. Kind of like to, you know, power forward. I think can make some plays as well. But, you know, I like to get on the forecheck and kind of get the puck back for our team and make room for other guys on the ice. And it's kind of been my style throughout my whole playing career. It just, you know, it depends. Obviously, there's some fluctuations in different leagues, right? You know, maybe making a little more plays and holding on to the puck a little more in college and stuff. But, you know, in the American League, just kind of, you know, be sound defensively, kind of bring energy and win my battles and kind of make room for guys on the ice. I'd say that's what I intend to do at least.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, I'm trying to be a scorer. You know, basically I've got a decent shot. Just trying to put the puck in the net. I mean, I've got a pretty big body. I like to. I'm working on that, but I'm trying to be hitting a little harder. You know, if I can be physical on forechecks or when guys have the puck, that'd be really helpful in my game. And yeah, just wait for bros to give me the puck, and then I try to bury it.
Just shoot.
Just shoot. I'm a shooter.
Yeah, for me, I think mine's pretty simple. It's stop the puck. I think I also love playing the puck too. So it's actually been fantastic to watch Smitty in practice playing the puck, because I get to learn a lot from him and you know, learn some experiences from watching him try some new things out. So I like to play the puck and I like to stop pucks. And the role I have in the dressing room is just have a muzzy at all times.
Hey fellas, I just want to thank you guys all for taking the time for us today and coming on and chat with us. Obviously we're big fans of all you guys, and we can't wait to see you play in Abbotsford or in Vancouver, one or the other. We guys are going to be in the Oilers organization, so I'm sure we'll see you this year, and you got fans with us for life.
That's for sure.
Yeah,
thanks for having us.
Appreciate it. Thank you so much, appreciate it.
For the most beers on tap, great steaks, great staff, head over to the John B. Pub.
We got the best beers, steaks, chicken wings, nachos in town. Come see us at the John B. Pub.
The John B. Pub, the best bar in town. Come sign up for our football pool. Say hey, St. You.